Hello, I'm Christy, and welcome to my reading journal. I want to do a mid-July update on where I'm at. So far, I've read 13 books this month, finishing the 13th just today. And these are all the different places I've traveled in books. I'm still reading the one that's taking place in Bermuda, so that won't be in here, but there's plenty of places that I've been in the books. And as of right now, I only have grilling left. I think there was grilling in one of the books, but it just flew by so fast that I didn't mark it because I'm not 100% on that. And then we've got six decades, but the 1900s, the 1940s are lumped together. And I think there's one in the 20s and one in the 40s that's there. So let's go through. I did do the Summer Ween Challenge and I read a few books for that one. The first book I read this month was Lost in Time by A.G. Riddle. And I gave this 4.5 stars. It was 11.5 hours on audiobook, 455 pages, published in 2022, and I chose Time After Time by Cyndi Lauper. I really enjoyed this one. It's a time paradox book. So it's like, which came first, the chicken or the egg? Did the egg get hatched and then you had a chicken, or did the chicken travel back in time and then there was an egg? I'm not really going to go into that. It has nothing to do with that analogy, really. Just the fact that there is time travel involved. There's dinosaurs. There's a whole prison system where they send prisoners back in time instead of putting them on death row. It revolves around this like group of scientists and the person who funds them, and follows mainly the life of the guy who gets sentenced out of the scientist, who gets framed from the scientist, and his daughter. And it was really interesting and I do recommend it. In fact, I recommended it to my oldest son and he has this on his list of now of something to read. And then I read Survive the Night by Riley Sager, which I gave 4 stars. And it is 9 hours long, 324 pages, was published in 2021. And I chose the song Come As You Are by Nirvana. It actually is a song that's highlighted several times within the book. Now, think of like a stereotypical horror movie where you're yelling at the main character going, don't go through there. What? Why didn't you do this? Why are you so stupid? Yeah, that's basically how I felt about the main character, Charlie, who is actually a girl, not a guy. Her name's Charlie, and she makes all the wrong moves. She's so stupid in this. But it goes along with the whole like horror movie theme of it. But basically, she may or may not be hitching a ride with a serial killer. And she just has to survive the night, basically. This won't be for everybody, but if you can go into it, if you being okay with yelling at the main person for at least half the book, if not like 3/4 of the book, then you'll be fine. It does have like twists in it, which is a great Riley Sager. It is well written. So I still recommend it, but go in there with just knowing that the main person doesn't do the smart thing ever. And then I read The Great Gatsby, which I've never read before, by Scott Fitzgerald. That did check off my TBR list of things I want to read. It was published in 1925. It's 5 hours long and 180 pages. I chose the song Money by The Flying Lizards because that really represents Daisy and her whole point of view. I have avoided anything to do with this book forever. I've never seen any of the movies or anything like this, so I just went in this stone cold, not knowing, except I knew it was about the 20s, rich people and parties. Yeah, but it's more than that. It's about how people feel about money and society and how they fit in society and what they're willing to do to stay there, even if it means not being happy. And there was a twist ending that, wow, you know, and I feel bad for Gatsby. I'm just going to leave it there because I'm sure a lot of people already know all this stuff. I never did because, like I said, I avoided it. And then I reread from a million years ago, The Little Prince by Antoine de Saint, I can't pronounce his last name. It was 2 hours long, 96 pages, and published in 1943. I own a copy of the book, but I did read it on ebook because it is available on audiobook, but oh, you know what? No, I read it on ebook and I listened to it on an audiobook as soon as it came in because it was really hard for me to get a hold of the audiobook. So I did both at the same time. And I chose A Sky Full of Stars by Coldplay to represent it. I did give it 3 stars. I remember absolutely loving it when I was younger, but the 3 stars is more of an honest thing as an adult reading it. Although I feel bad about that because I have such nostalgia revolving around this book and around the movie that I think is from the 70s, which we watched some of it recently. And just me like always thinking about this little guy walking around his tiny little planet with his little rose. It's really sweet. It's really cute. It takes place in the Sahara Desert as well as outer space, and it's quirky. I really don't think I should dive into what it's all about because it's such a classic that I feel that most people should already know something about it. And then I reread Ender's Game by Orson Scott Card because I want to read the whole series, but I had only read the first book and it was a long time ago. So I reread that and I gave it 5 stars once again because I really like it. It's really good. It's 11 hours long on audio, 324 pages, published in 1985. And like I said, it's book one in a whole series by Orson Scott Card. I chose Hall of Fame by The Script in Will I Am for the song. And I did read it for Summerween, although I know Summerween's all about thrillers and everything, but if you can't count the genocide of a whole species and like killing somebody to death, beating somebody to death twice, then I mean, it should count. It's really about this boy who I think at 6 years old, his parents are allowed to have a third child, which in this society, you're not really allowed to have more than two. And the government wants them to have a third because the oldest son is basically a psychopath. And the middle child is a daughter who she is too empathetic. And they wanted a third child from them because the kids were super smart and they wanted to see if Ender, like the third child Ender, would fit into what they wanted for their military to help defeat these bug-like creatures who once attacked us and killed a whole bunch of people. So they're training all these children in space to one day fight a third war against these bugs because there was a second war at some point. And one of my favorite parts of this whole thing that stuck with me since the first time I read it was when a bully at school picked on Ender, and basically Ender like beat him to a pulp, and it wasn't that Ender wanted to. He didn't want to do it, but he said if he only like hit him and just beat him for the day, the guy would keep coming back at him. So he wanted to make sure he beat him enough to stop it dead in the tracks so it wouldn't happen again. And that's always kind of stuck with me. Anyway, and then the hardest reading challenge you'll ever do started on July 7th. So that's when I read An Ember in the Ashes by Saba Tahir. It's book one in a 4-book series. I gave it 5 stars. So that means 2 5-stars in a row for me. It's 15 hours long, 446 pages, and was published in 2015. I chose Swan Dive by Annie DeFranco for the song. And I love this book. I can't wait to read the other 3 books in the series. So Layla is this girl who, we're living in a whole other world with a whole other society. And there was Layla's ancestors were there, and this other group of like fighters came in and took over. And now her people have either been turned into slaves or just meek out a living, which is what her and her brother and grandparents do. Her parents were part of the resistance, and her mom was like the head of the resistance. And both of them have been dead since she was like four. And so these mask people come in, like one mask person who is like trained from childhood to be this deadly killer, comes in with a bunch of the, I guess, army military people from the king, and they want something from her brother. They arrest him. They kill her grandparents. They were most likely going to rape and murder her. And, but she escaped, and they burned down her house. So she goes to the rebels hoping that they would help her, since her mother used to be the head of it. And then they sign her this impossible mission of becoming a slave for this woman who, this commandant who is just, she's evil. And then trying to survive that, just to help get her brother out. And then at the same time, she meets the commandant's son, who is the best at the mask military school. And they don't have, like, the mom and the son don't have a good relationship. And she kind of gets to know that guy, and he's actually a good guy. And I don't want to go any further in that, because if I go any further, it's going to give a whole bunch of stuff away. And there's like a Hunger Games type of situation happening within the little military school as well. It's really good. I really recommend it. And then I read The Love of My Afterlife by Kirsty Greenwood, third 5-star in a row this month, 9.5 hours long, published just this month, and 384 pages. And I chose Being Alive by Barbara Streisand. It actually mentions the song in the book, but sung by somebody else. I just didn't like that person's version. So I used Barbara Streisand's version. Basically, you've got this girl, Delphi, who chokes on a burger and dies and wakes up in like this weird like holding room of the afterlife. And her afterlife therapist, to say, is really into romantic comedies and romance books and all that. And Delphi like really wants to go back to Earth, but while she's in the waiting room, she meets this other guy, and I don't remember if his name's Jonah or Lucas. I don't remember. They have instant chemistry. So M is like, you know what? I'm going to bend the rules. I'm going to send you back for 10 days. And you have to find this guy who she only knows his first name and knows that he lives in London. That's all she knows. And she's like, you got to go back, and he's got to willingly kiss you. And if he can willingly kiss you, you get to stay alive. And then, you know, she's such a shut-in, Delphi. She has no friends, no loved ones, no real connection to anybody. And because of this, she has to put herself out there to find this guy. She ends up making friends along the way and getting to know like this other neighbor. She takes care of this elderly neighbor that lives next to her, but she gets to know this grumpy other neighbor. And there's a whole grumpy sunshine. Well, not really grumpy sunshine. She's not a sunshine. I guess a grumpy connection going on. And it was really cute. And I enjoyed it. That's that. And then I read Meddling Kids by Edgar Cantero. I gave it 2 stars. It's 13 hours long, 322 pages, and published July 2017. And I chose Things That Go Bump in the Night by All Stars. And it is loosely based on Scooby-Doo and this other group from some other country called, like, I think, some other group of five, like, people, like, you know, the four kids and the animal, as well as H.P. Lovecraft. So you're kind of merging those worlds together. And the kids, they had this summer detective club, and they during summer camp where they all met. And at age 11, these meddling kids got this one guy arrested for pretending to be some sort of lake monster. And now that he's getting out of jail, and it's several years later, and they're all in their 20s, 13 years later, one of the girls, Andy, doesn't believe that they actually solved the case and gets the gang back together. However, Peter became famous actor, but he ended up committing suicide, so he's dead. So it's just the four. So Andy's a tomboy, a lesbian. She's quick to anger. She's lethal in fighting. Carrie got contact. She's the brain of the operation, and she's the one with the orange hair and is beautiful. And Carrie's cousin Nate, who is in a mental institution now, and Carrie's dog Tim, who is the grandson of Sean, who was the original dog back in the 70s. So the original arrest took place in 1977. Now it's 1990. And so they're going back and figuring out what all happened. And as it turns out, it's not some guy in a mask. It's all real. And I really wanted to like this. I love Mystery Incorporated. Love it, love it, love it. But I would have DNF'd if it wasn't for this challenge that I'm doing where you're not allowed to DNF a book. And I'm just highly disappointed that I didn't find this interesting at all, because I really wanted to. And then I read Into the Water by Paula Hawkins. I gave 4 stars. It's 11 and a half hours, 386 pages, published in 2017. And I chose the title Into the Water by Lost Portals for the song. This one is a weird kind of murder mystery. You got multiple POVs. Basically, way back when, they used to do witch trials at this river. And where, you know, if a girl floats, she's a witch, and if she sinks, she's human, or vice versa, I don't know. And so a lot of girls died during that time, and then that same spot is known as, I guess, a suicide spot, because people have committed suicide over time. And this summer, earlier in the summer, this girl, Katie, who's 15, committed suicide. And then I think about a month later, this other woman, Nell, also died there. They believe she committed suicide. And a few years before that, this other woman also, they believe, committed suicide there. Now the big question is, was Katie the only one who committed suicide? Or was Nell murdered? And Nell was researching whether or not the other woman was murdered as well. And you get all these different people's perspectives and trying to find out who killed who. And Nell believed that this area was a place for men to get rid of unruly women who wouldn't follow what they wanted them to do. I enjoyed it. I did. And then I read Assistant to the Villain. I gave 4 stars, 342 pages, 14 hours, published last year, and it's book one. I think the next book just came out or is coming out next month. And I chose My Eyes from Dr. Horrible's sing-along blog, sung by Neil Patrick Harris and Felicia Day. And online it's described as The Office meets Once Upon a Time. I thought it was really fun, really quirky, funny, cute, that whole thing. Basically, you got this girl, Evie, who leaves her job because she's physically attacked by her boss, the blacksmith. And Now she's out of work, but she's the sole provider for her 10-year-old sister and her dad, who's ill. And she ends up getting a job with the villain as his assistant. And so from that, she finds out that his place where he operates from is run just like an office. It's got all these great people, some not so great, but some, you know, really great that work there. Somebody makes something that sounds like a donut, and there's this other guy trying to train a dragon, and but occasionally there's like severed heads hanging from the ceiling from her boss. But she gets to know that the villain isn't so bad, and she's really attracted to him. And there's a whole love thing between her and the villain, and then there's a big cliffhanger ending and some twists and turns towards the end. And I just thought the vibe of it was really cute. Her whole quirkiness and everything I loved. And then slowly over a week, at bedtime, I read A Beautiful Day in the Neighborhood, poetry by Mr. Rogers, by Fred Rogers himself. Now the audiobook technically is apparently 4 hours long, but it only took me an hour, basically 50 minutes really, to read this over the week's time. So I read an ebook, 147 pages, and published in 2019, which is after his death. It is a book of all the songs from both Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood and The Children's Corner, which he also worked on. And it's all very sweet and wholesome and innocent. I couldn't give it less than 4 stars because it's Mr. Rogers and it's so sweet and innocent and wholesome. But it is really made for a child. But I had the challenge of trying to read a children's book, not children's book, I'm sorry, poetry book. And I don't really like poetry books. And this qualified as a poetry book. So why not? And I recognize some of the songs from it. And it just is really sweet. And I chose the song Let's Think of Something to Do, sung by Mr. Rogers himself. I haven't printed out the sticker yet for that. And just today, I finished A Holly Jolly Diwali by Sonia Lawley. 7 hours, 336 pages, and published in 2021, and I gave 3.5 stars. And I cannot pronounce the song, but it is a Bollywood song that it has become popular for weddings and other celebrations. But basically, you got this girl, Nikki. She's like a type A personality. She lives in Seattle. She's finally become like middle management at where she works, but they let her go because they're letting go of all the middle management people, big layoff. So now she's out of work, but now she can go to this wedding of her friend in India. So she travels there just to get away and have something to do. And she ends up being really attracted to this guitarist of this band that was playing at one of the parties, Sam. And Sam happens to be the formerly dorky friend of her friend who's getting married. Formerly dorky because he's really hot now, but he's really sweet. And they have an instant connection, and even his mom absolutely loves Nikki. And she's like, sure, I'll just have this summer fling, but they both develop feelings. But something happens, and they end up parting ways, and they're both really brokenhearted. And you know it's gonna have a happy ending. It is a definite Hallmark-style romance. It was sweet. You knew exactly what was going to happen. But it was a lovely thing to read. So it was nice. It was a cozy book, basically. Now, I accidentally skipped these 2 pages when doing my layout. So I have one more book to show that I actually finished before this one over here. And that's The Outsider by Stephen King. I gave it 5 stars. 19 hours long, published in 2018, 561 pages. It's book one in the Holly Gibney trilogy. However, I count it as book four because there was the Bill Hodges series trilogy, which, you know, start with Mr. Mercedes, and Holly's been in all of those. So I feel like technically it's book four. And I chose The Troubles by U2 and Leaky Lai for the song. Now, this was part of the hardest reading challenge you'll ever do, where you have to read 500-page book in one day, and I did. And so good. I was told that it was better than Holly. I read Holly out of order already. But Holly doesn't come in until like midway into the book. Because I was like, oh my God, I thought this had Holly. I thought this had Holly. When is Holly going to show up? But you've got this heinous murder of a child. And all the fingerprints and DNA point to this man of the year little league coach, who's the nicest guy. However, there is all this evidence, including very good video evidence, of him being far away during all of this. So there's all this evidence of him being completely innocent, but all this evidence of him being completely guilty, and how can he be at two far away places at the same exact moment, and what actually happened. And then they find out that something similar has happened somewhere else, and that's all I'm going to get into, because I will totally give it away. It does have a supernatural element to it, in a way similar to Mr. Mercedes, but in a way not similar. So yeah, really good. So I've read 4 5-star books this month, so I'm riding on a high right now from that. And if you've been following my shorts, you would have seen me putting all the stickers into here. And I'll just quickly go through my new thing. I was doodling one night while trying to finish The Outsider. So the hardest reading challenge you ever do was put together by QWERTY. And so for The Outsider, I finished read a 500-page book in one day. So I've got one bingo thing marked off. And then for the genre challenge, I've got my fantasy as An Ember in the Ashes. My mystery thriller, Into the Water. Horror is Stephen King. And romance is The Love of My Afterlife. Now, all of these may change, but I do want to kind of keep these as only 4 and 5 stars here, because all the purple ones you can overlap on books, and all the white ones you can't. Then the A to Z challenge, you know, as always in the beginning, it's so easy. So I've got all the books here, because from when the challenge began on July 7th, because that's pretty easy. I don't think I filled in anything over here for my personal like author name challenge, because I'm trying to do the last name. First name would count, but I'm trying to only do the last name. The name challenge, it's your full name. I do have my full name in here. I'm not going to share that page, but my first name, I've got all but 2 letters in my first name. Meddling Kids, I've got the lesbian one covered. I might, if I read something else that doesn't qualify for something else, I'll cover that one. And then over here in the color, the book cover color challenge, I've got Assistant to the Village for purple and An Ember in the Ashes for red. The other two of the other books for An Ember in the Ashes will cover the blue and the green. And then I'm planning on another book this month that will cover the orange. And yeah, and black will be pretty easy to cover with some of the other stuff I read. And then there it is right there, the 500-page book in a day, The Outsider. 5 books from 5 small booktuber recommendations, and The Assistant to the Villain, I saw a video by The Great Gatsby, who recommended that. And then books that take place in 5 different countries, or books, yeah. So the Holly Jolly Diwali, yeah, it was in Seattle, but it was also in 2 different places in India. And then 5 books with the lowest rating on your Goodreads TBR. The fourth lowest was Meddling Kids with a Goodreads average of 3.54. Technically, Holly Jolly Diwali could have fit right here, but it was tied with Moby Dick. So I'm going to be reading Moby Dick for that one. And then read an entire 4+ book series, so An Ember in the Ashes. Read a book in the four seasons during that season, so for the summer, Into the Water. However, The Outsider could have been there as well. And then right here for new releases, read in the month that they are released in, and Love of My Afterlife was released this month. Thank you. If you watched this all the way to the end, I appreciate that so much. Do check out my shorts when I plug in different things into this, and I hope you have a great rest of your week. Thanks.